Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Book of Collateral Damage by Sinan Antoon. Translated by Jonathan Wright. Narrated by Fajer Al-Kaisi. He left many blank pages in it. On Al-Fihris, the Index, by Ibn al-Nadim. They speak for the dead and translate the speech of the living. Al-Jahiz, on books. Every passion borders on the chaotic, but the collector's passion borders on the chaos of memories. Walter Benjamin. Time is the substance I am made of. Time is a river which sweeps me along, but I am not the river. It is the tiger which destroys me, but I am the tiger. It is a fire which consumes me, but I am the fire. Jorge Luis Borges, A New Refutation of Time. We are our memory. We are that chimerical museum of shifting shapes, that pile of broken mirrors. Borges, Cambridge. Beginnings. The Colloquy of the Birds. I can still remember the first time I flew. "Come on, it's time," my father said firmly before flying off. My mother pushed me gently with her beak toward the edge and whispered, "Don't be frightened, my little one. You'll fly. We all fly. I'll be right behind you." My three siblings were flying happily in the sky, oblivious to me. My heart was pounding, as if it, too, were also worried its wings might let it down, as if, like me, it was torn between the fear inside, which kept me in or close to the nest, and an overwhelming desire that compelled me to be like the grown-ups. I moved forward warily to the tip of the branch, which dipped a little with my weight and that of my mother behind me. I didn't look down. I looked up, where my father was circling in a clear, cloudless sky. I spread my wings, then looked back toward my mother. She didn't say anything this time, but her eyes gave me courage, and she kissed my head with her beak. I remembered how she had often told me that we have strong wings and that mine would one day carry me to distant lands. I looked ahead and summoned all my courage and flapped my wings with vigor. And I took off. I couldn't believe myself. I flew with confidence, as if I had often flown before. The cold air swept past my white feathers. The whole sky was mine, and the whole earth was laid out below me. With a flip of a wing, I could twist and turn, rise and fall. I kept flying till the sun bade us farewell. I was the last to return home that day. I laugh now, and I'm embarrassed, too, when I remember that moment and the fear that later left me. Here I am now, flying with the grown-ups for days on our journey to the warm lands. A drop of sweat fell on the edge of the piece of paper, and I stopped reading. His handwriting was neat and confident. The ink was black, maybe from a ballpoint pen. The words were perched like birds on lines that looked like small sky-blue threads running across small brown pages. I probably thought of this because he had written about the sky and flying. The passage reminded me of the stork's nest I used to see in Shurja, on the dome of a building when I was young. I turned the page. The title of the passage that followed also began with the word colloquy. The air conditioning unit in the room was panting and sputtering, and the pores of my skin were oozing sweat from the heat. I wiped the drop of sweat off the page with my finger and caught another one that was rolling down my forehead and about to drop. I left the pages on the bed next to the buff-colored notebook, stood up, went to the air conditioning unit, and turned the dial counterclockwise as far as possible. I went to the bathroom and washed my face in cold water. I dried it with the towel and went back to stand in front of the air conditioner unit for 30 seconds. I thought about the long, tiring journey to Amman. I had to pack and sleep a little, because we were scheduled to leave Baghdad at 6 a.m. I went back to the bed and read his letter a second time. Dear Mr. al-Baghdadi, I hope you had a productive day in the arms of your fatigued Baghdad. Apologies for intruding and daring to disturb you. But I've thought long and hard about the happy coincidence that brought us together, and about your sincere interest in my project and your kind offer to translate it, although I'm not in a hurry to have it translated or even published, as I mentioned, at least not for now. I decided to take a risk and lay claim to more of your generosity and kindness. I sat down waiting for you at the hotel reception until half an hour before the start of the curfew, so that I could deliver this part of the manuscript to you personally. But you didn't come back. That's why I'm writing this letter. I attach the first chapter. It's the history of the first minute, which has yet to be completed, and I do have my own opinions on whether texts end or not. And I might tell you about them in the future. I hope you like it, and I hope you'll give me your opinion with the candor and rigor of a critic and a writer, even if it is negative. With this letter, you'll find a simple gift, because books are all I have in this world. I'll try to obtain an email account so that we can communicate across the continents and the oceans. Thank you in advance, and I apologize again if I was a little rude at the beginning of our meeting. I'm not usually much good at dealing with people, and I prefer books because they never hurt or betray. With affection, your brother, Wadood Abdul Karim, Baghdad, July 29th, 2003. He's not interested in being translated or published, so why is he sharing his manuscript with me so readily? Does he care that much what a stranger thinks? He's strange, this Wadood. I folded the letter up and put it in the notebook I had bought specially to record my impressions during this visit. It had large pages that were slightly tan. The edges were stitched and trimmed unevenly to look like an old book. It had a thick cover of buff leather and a thin red ribbon attached to the top of the spine as a place marker. The marker was still on the first page, where I had written just one word since arriving. Baghdad. I envied Wadood his productivity. I can't even begin. And all this concern, or rather obsession, with writing rituals and instruments only ends in blank pages and silence. The visit had, of course, been hectic and hurried, and the pace of the work and daily travel exhausted me physically and mentally, leaving no time to write or even to think in peace. I have yet to start processing the whirl of scenes and people and ambivalent emotions. Nevertheless, I should have written something, one sentence at least. Every night I came back exhausted and sat on the bed. I picked up my pen but didn't manage to write anything. The first night was the only night I wrote anything. That one word, Baghdad. I went back to thinking about his manuscript and his gift, which wasn't simple at all. Yes, it wasn't the first edition, only the second, but it was the first part of the collected poems of Abdul Al-Karkhi. And it does date back to 1956, and I think it's rare. The book is in excellent condition. I browsed through the first few pages. There was a dedication to King Ghazi and a photograph of him on the next page. Then one of Al-Karkhi. The introduction was a collection of tributes and essays. There was a poem by Al-Rusafi entitled To the Poet of the Nation. What a fine man you are, Abud. With your rhymes you raise the banner of Zajal. Another poem by Al-Zahawi. An essay by Raphael Bouti on the use of colloquial Arabic in poetry and prose. And by Al-Rusafi on Zajal poetry and popular forms of literature. Another one by Muhammad Bahjat Al-Athari on colloquial and classical Arabic. And then, finally, the poems themselves. As I expected, The Crusher, Al-Karkhi's most famous poem, was the first in the collection. I fell asleep before I was halfway through and dreamed that Al-Karkhi was our driver on the journey to Amman. All the way he recited his poems and explained their context and how they came about, but Roy kept insisting that I translate them. I lost my temper with him and said, "Poetry can't be translated that way. We're not at a press conference." And I kept repeating, "One hour and I'll break the crusher and curse this damned life of mine." Al-Karkhi roared with laughter and said, "How did you get stuck with them?" I woke up to loud banging on the door of my room and Roy's voice saying, "Come on, Namir, we have to leave in half an hour. Don't you want to eat breakfast?" I had a shower in record time, dressed hurriedly, and stuffed the rest of my clothes and other things into my bag. I hadn't bought anything other than the books from al-Mutanabbi Street. My bag was big enough for them and the box of cookies that my aunt had given me. I put Wadood's envelope, my notebook, and the al-Kerhi poems in my backpack with my passport. I hate to be late for a departure or any appointment, but I had another, much more important reason for hurrying. I wanted to savor one last time the Iraqi-style clotted cream and the hot sammoon bread that arrived fresh every morning from a bakery close to the tiny hotel in Karada. When I went down to the ground floor, Roy was going over the bill with the receptionist, who spoke enough English for them to understand each other, and I was already sick of translating. "Do you need any help?" I asked him anyway. "No, everything's cool. You have some time because Laura is still packing and needs 20 minutes. The driver hasn't arrived yet either." I put my bag next to Roy's big bag close to the front door and went to the hotel restaurant, a small room with four tables and a door that led to the kitchen. Abid, the waiter, saw me from inside the kitchen and we exchanged greetings. I sat down at a table on the right, turned my cup over, took a Lipton tea bag from the plate in the middle of the table, and put it in the cup. If it had been real tea, from a teapot and flavored with cardamom, the breakfast would have been perfect. In America, I had stopped drinking tea. Especially after I moved out of my family's house and switched to coffee. 2 minutes later, Abid arrived, carrying a tray with a small bowl of clotted cream, another with date syrup, and a blue plastic basket holding two loaves of some moon bread. He put the tray on the table in front of me, then went back to the kitchen to fetch the hot water for the tea. He hadn't said much, except for the first day we had breakfast, a week earlier. He asked me at the time about my traveling companions.
"Excuse me, sir, but the group you're with, what's their story?" he said.
"They're married, and they've come to shoot a documentary," I replied.
"Really? A month ago there was a group of French people staying here who were making a film too. Very well. And you would be the director?" he asked.
"No, I just came with them to translate for them and help them."
"Do you live abroad?"
"Yes."
"Where?"
"In the US, I said.
"How long have you been away?"
"Since 1993. I asked him about his work.
"I've been working in this hotel for 4 years, he replied. "Our house is in Camp Sara, but for the last few months, since the fall of Baghdad, I go there only once a week. I sleep here."
We didn't speak after that. He was always busy with his work, and over breakfast, Roy, Laura, and I had discussed the day's schedule and the places we were going to film. As he poured the hot water into the cup, he asked,
"It looks like you're leaving today, sir?"
"Yes, that's right."
"Hope you have a safe trip. Which city do you live in, sir?"
"In Boston," I said. "But in 1 week, I'm going to move to a state called New Hampshire," I added for accuracy.
"I've never heard of it, to be honest."
"It's on the border with Canada. Very cold," I said.
"The cold's easier to take than this damned heat. What do you do there?"
"I've got a job at a university," I replied.
"Congratulations! I hope it goes well."
I expected him to ask what my discipline was, but a voice called him from the kitchen.
"Excuse me, sir," he said politely.
I put two spoonfuls of sugar in the cup of tea and stirred it. I took a sip and almost scorched my tongue and put the cup back. I took a loaf of samoon, split it open along the side, and spread the cream inside, adding two spoonfuls of the date syrup. Abid didn't come back. I ate slowly to enjoy my last breakfast. I had tasted this gemar back in America on a visit to San Diego, where many Iraqis live, but it tasted different there. This cream reminded me of Jalil's cream, which she used to leave in a bowl on the stoop of our house early in the morning. I remembered how a stray cat rubbed its nose in the cream one morning and made off with some of it. Would Jalil still be alive? I examined the sole painting hanging on the wall opposite. It was an attempt to draw a traditional Baghdadi backstreet. There were women in abayas carrying baskets with the dome of a mosque, a minaret, and a sunset scene in the background. The colors were garish, and there were unintentional mistakes in the perspective and the proportions. An attempt to reproduce a sense of authenticity, but it fell into the trap of self-orientalism. I reproached myself silently for the way I was overanalyzing. There I was, thinking like an academic even before I officially started my new job. I had seen many of these paintings in the city, sold to journalists and newcomers. I remembered that the department chair had asked me in an email to decide what course I planned to teach, apart from Arabic, so that it could be added to the curriculum, and I had to decide quickly. The woman who had held the position before me had taught a class on Andalusian literature. The chair suggested I teach that too, and then I could propose another course for the following year. I didn't have enough time to prepare a new course, and Andalusian literature would be an opportunity to reduce the number of questions on terrorism and jihad, which had intruded on every class and lecture since 9/11. I began the rituals of preparing another piece of sammoon and cream, but Roy's voice called from the reception.
"Hey, Namir! Laura's ready and the driver's waiting!"
I finished making the sandwich, wrapped it in a paper napkin that was on the table, put it in one of the pockets of my backpack, and drank the cup of tea, which wasn't quite so hot. Mullah Abud al-Karkhi wasn't in the driver's seat, just Abdul Arif, the Jordanian driver who had been with us throughout the visit and who worked on the Amman-Baghdad route and knew Baghdad well. Roy and Laura sat in the front seat next to the driver, while I took the back seat so I could stretch out and sleep. Baghdad was still sleepy and yawning. Most of the shops had their eyes shut. There were some people on the sidewalks, but the streets were semi-deserted. A car drove past us from time to time. American tanks and armored vehicles were lurking at the junctions. Someone had written, "U.S. Army, go home," in red paint on a wall. I was the one going back to the country that the U.S. Army came from, while it looked likely to stay. I was going back to a country that was not yet home, even after a full decade. I had read expressions of gratitude to the Americans on other walls that made me sad. I wanted to see the Tigris and say goodbye to it. I didn't know when I would come back, or whether I ever would. The Tigris looked so pale on this visit. It no longer looked the way I remembered it. But did anything still look the way I remembered? Nothing had managed to escape turning pale. A pigeon fancier had awakened early to let out his flock and watch the pigeons circle in the city sky. Seeing the birds in flight suggested an answer to my question, an answer that gave wing to a simple joy. The doves were still as they were, beautiful and free. Free at least for this fleeting moment. The doves reminded me of the stork in Wadood's manuscript. I thought about him coming to the hotel and leaving his manuscript for me. It struck me as a rather strange and impulsive gesture. Or was I exaggerating and being too hard on him? Hadn't I asked him to write to me? Hadn't I offered to help? My sudden return to Baghdad with these Americans was also strange and impulsive. Had I come to rediscover something, or to make sure it was lost? Wasn't I ill at ease in this city and in a hurry to leave? Had I come back to examine the wounds I had left behind, or what? I wanted to read the rest of the manuscript, but not now because I was exhausted and sleepy. Later. It was a long way to Amman. I woke up after about 2 hours to find desert stretching away on both sides of the road. I asked the driver where we were.
"We passed Ramadi an hour ago. The others are sleeping too."
I looked at them. Laura's head was in Roy's arms, and his was resting on the small bag that he used as a pillow.
"Didn't they stop us along the way?"
I asked.
"No," he said. "Only at the first checkpoint at Abu Ghraib."
"How long to the border?" I asked.
"We've got Al-Rutba in an hour and a half, and then about an hour after that we get to the border."
He paused and then, looking at me in the big rearview mirror and half smiling, he added,
"What? You're in a hurry to get out of Iraq, Mr. Namir?
He took every opportunity to make bad-tempered and malicious remarks. Twice I had argued with him angrily, and I raised my voice so loud that I upset Roy. On one occasion, I had confronted him, saying, "You love Saddam." He was evasive, saying,
"No, but I'm not with the Americans."
"And what makes you think I'm with the Americans?" I replied. But then I decided there was nothing to be gained by arguing with him.
"No, Abu Arif," I said. "That's unfair. Did you ever have a passenger who didn't ask where we are and when we'll arrive?" "Just joking," he laughed.
I was going to tell him that I missed being myself and on my own. I was tired of translating everything that was said. I had spent 6 whole days with them. Roy, Laura, and Abu Arif too. From early morning to sunset, we had gone everywhere conducting interviews and filming. They were pleasant, and working with them was easy, but 6 days was enough. The day before had been the only day when I was able to breathe and move around freely. Abu Arif took them to Al-Nahar Street and the copper workers' market to buy gifts, walk around the markets, and then have some traditional grilled fish to eat. I had gone to Al-Mutanabbi Street to wander around and buy books. After that, I went to our old house and then my aunt's, who had prepared a meal of stuffed grape leaves for me and invited relatives for me to meet. She pressed me to invite your American friends that you're filming with, but I told her I preferred to come alone. "They don't speak Arabic, auntie," I said, "and if they come, I'll have to keep translating for them and I won't be able to enjoy being with you. Besides, they're busy tomorrow."
"As you wish, then. Okay, do you remember our house? Can you find the way on your own?"
"Of course I can. What do you mean?" I said. "I used to go there as a child in the summer and play with my cousins and sleep there days at a time." I walked a little, then took a taxi from Al-Rusafi Square to our house in Al-Amin Al-Ula, which was later changed to Al-Khalij. I wanted to take a look at it and say hello to any of our neighbors who were still there. When we were about to approach the Al-Amin Bridge, I asked the driver not to cross to the other side of the canal because the street that led to the house was directly on the right. The cars slowed down and we saw a traffic jam in front of the street that led to our neighborhood. Some of the cars were turning and driving back toward us in the opposite direction. There were some Hummers and American troops waving the cars back. The driver wound down the window and shouted at one of the drivers who were coming back.
"What's going on?"
"The street's blocked," the other driver replied. "And they're not letting anyone in."
He looked at me with a sigh.
"I know another way," I said. "We can go back and get in near the courthouse and through the back streets."
"Are you sure?"
"Yes."
He turned the car around and we went back. We turned at the traffic circle and took one of the streets leading to our street, but then we saw a Hummer parked at the end of the street. There was a man standing outside his house with a child, and I asked him what was going on.
"They've been sealing off the area for an hour," he said.
I thought of getting out of the taxi and walking.
"Are they letting pedestrians through?" I asked him.
He shook his head and said,
"No, no pedestrians and no vehicles."
The driver was looking at me and expecting me to pay the fare, so I asked him, "Can you take me to Beirut Square?" And he agreed. I felt a lump in the throat. I had wanted to have a look at the house and the street I had played and run around in. I had thought I would knock on the neighbor's door and ask about my childhood friends. The taxi driver didn't speak throughout the ride. I wiped my sweat away with a handkerchief I was carrying after he dropped me off in front of my aunt's house. I saw 3 cars parked on the pavement. I pressed the bell outside, then pushed the metal gate, which was a little rusty and had flaking white paint. The garden wasn't as lush as it used to be. My aunt's husband, who had died 3 or 4 years earlier, had treated the garden as sacred ground. I noticed they had added some rooms to the second floor. There was a separate entrance with a staircase. My aunt came out through the front door and started ululating. Her face was still the same, except for the wrinkles, but most of her hair had disappeared beneath a black hijab that she hadn't worn before I left Baghdad. Wiyam, her eldest son, came out behind her. I later learned that he and his wife and children were the ones living on the second floor. She cried as she hugged and kissed me,
and started to scold me, of course.
"Shame on you. You've been here a whole week and you only come on the last day," she said. "We haven't seen you for 10 years. Don't you love your auntie any longer, you rascal?"
"The man's a doctor now, and still you call him a rascal?" Wiam told her. I gave him a kiss and said, "I'm not a doctor yet. My dissertation isn't finished yet." He laughed and said, "All but a doctor." The others were waiting inside. My cousins, my other uncle and his wife, and their children and their wives and children. I greeted them one by one and tried to remember the names of the children and the people I hadn't met before. As for the grown-ups I had known before, time seemed to have crushed them like a steamroller, as if they had had to live through the last 10 years several times over, back and forth, and had endured massive doses of pain.
"Why don't you stay here with us for a few days, my dear?"
my aunt asked me as soon as I sat down. "Unfortunately, I have to go back to Amman tomorrow."
"You mean you couldn't put off traveling for a few days?"
"No, auntie, I have to go back. I have a stack of new responsibilities. I have to move to a new state and get ready to teach." When I had called her to tell her I was in Baghdad, she had wanted me to leave the hotel and stay at her house.
"It's a shame to come to Baghdad and stay in a hotel. Bring your American friends to stay at our place. We can make room for them. Bring them over," she said.
I told her that the filming schedule wouldn't allow it, and they had to charge the batteries for their equipment every night, and so we had to be in a place where there were no power cuts.
"We have a generator, dear," she said.
My uncle, a retired engineer, was the only one to ask about my dissertation and the academic work I was about to start. The others bombarded me with questions about America and life there, and what would happen in Iraq in the future, as if I knew or were in direct contact with Bush. Like the people whose words I had translated on camera for the past 6 days, my relatives were divided over what had happened. There was no consensus, even on the right term to use, occupation or liberation. There was an acrimonious argument between the men while my aunt supervised the preparation of the table. One of my cousins turned to me to ask me what I thought. He didn't like what I said and asked,
"So you came out to protest against the war?"
"Of course," I said. He laughed and said sarcastically,
"You are so spoiled, man. If you'd been living here with us all these years, even if the angel of death had come to liberate you, you would have welcomed him."
"America is the official agent of the angel of death," I said.
"Oh, really? So why do you live there?"
he asked in a loud voice.
"Enough," his father rebuked him. "You've gone too far."
My aunt called from the guest room.
"That's enough arguing. Come and eat."
I asked her about the tablets I'd seen her putting in the water jug. She told me it was to sterilize the water because otherwise it would cause diarrhea. She put plenty of dolma on my plate, especially stuffed onions, because she knew how much I loved them. Then she said,
"Is there food like this in America?"
"Where I live, there aren't any Iraqi restaurants," I said.
"You've been living as a bachelor all these years, so why haven't you learned to cook?" she asked.
"Sometimes I cook, but not dolma." After lunch, we went back to the living room. I felt quite exhausted and could hardly keep my eyes open, but I pretended to follow the discussion against a background of clinking teacups and the sound of drinking. My aunt saved me by suggesting I take a siesta on the sofa in the guest room under the opening of the air cooler.
"Where you used to sleep in summer when you came here, remember?"
I smiled.
"Of course I remember. Yes, please."
I took off my shoes and socks, put my head on the pillow she brought, and slept for an hour and a half. Then I woke up, washed my face, and went back to the living room. We chatted at length and drank tea again with the klecha cookies that my aunt had made specially for me. She gave me a full box of them to take with me. Before I said goodbye to them, my aunt pulled me by the arm and asked to speak to me alone. When she was alone with me, she told me off for cutting off my father and not speaking to him for years. I asked her whether she knew the reason, what he had done to my mother.
"It doesn't matter," she said. "Whatever happened, he's still your father. Be magnanimous and don't break his heart. For my sake, Namir, When you get back, speak to him, please.
I didn't want to disappoint her, so I promised to think about it. That was a white lie, like my promise that I would soon come back for a longer visit without work or other commitments. She made sure she sprinkled water after me so that I would come back. My cousin Midhat drove me to the hotel and gave me his phone number and email address before we said goodbye. The outer gate was locked, but the guard recognized me and opened it for me. I greeted the receptionist, who was watching television in the room next to the front desk. "My friend," he shouted, "there's a package for you." He got up from his chair, came to the reception desk, bent down looking for something, and then handed me a brown envelope. "Your friend Wadood," he said. "He waited here an hour and a half, and then he went, but asked me to pass this on to you." I was surprised. I thanked him, took the envelope, and went up to my room. Preamble, draft. How can I write what happened? This how kept me up at night for many years. And how can what I write escape the traps of distortion and domination of official history? I realize there's something paradoxical and ironic about it. Is it reasonable to worry about the fate of what I write before my pen even begins to bleed ink onto paper? There's a wonderful African proverb in Chinua Achebe's novel, Things Fall Apart, that goes, "Until lions have their own historians, the history of the hunt will always glorify the hunter." The idea isn't new, of course, but the metaphor is a gem. The victors are always the ones who write history. By the time someone who wants to revise, question, or change it comes along, it's already too late. But what about the history of the victim? Or the victim's victim? That's what I am concerned with. The first time I read that proverb, I empathized with the lion, of course, but then I thought hard about the matter and reconsidered to discover, or rather remember, that I should be in solidarity with the lion's victim. I imagined, even felt, that I was inhabiting the gazelle, or any other prey, in this equation because it represents me, and I represent it. I even feel I am it. I am the one who's been marginalized and disappeared at least twice. I'm the prey's prey. As for numbers, they don't serve the purpose. Statistics may count us, but at best they diminish our lives and our deaths. They dehumanize us. Assuming there's someone to count in the first place, because the historians of the hunt count the number of dead hunters. Numbers turn us into numbers. Dead signs and symbols in comparative studies designed to improve the hunt and make it more efficient. Our details disappear. Our features, our color, our voices, our memories, our skin, our eyes, and so on. Once we've been skinned, our skins might be tanned and hung on the wall in the hunters' homes. Or photographs of the hunters, standing next to our dead bodies to celebrate a new record, might be hung on museum walls. But where should I begin and how? Can I enter time through a hole or through the window of one moment in time? I believe so. As soon as I get inside time, I can take the moment and analyze it as if it's a tear or a drop of blood under the microscope and discover the bonds and interactions that produce it. But how can I describe the moment when it isn't a moment, but in fact more like a tree? So I have to get down to the roots and listen to the earth's conversation with the tree and what it drinks from the earth. Then there's the trunk and everyone who has ever leaned on it or carved their name on it, and the branches and their memory, and everything the wind has picked up and scattered far and wide, and all the birds that have perched on it on their way to distant places, and the ones that have nested in it, and so on. It's a labyrinth. And which particular moment are we talking about? Is the moment the same moment everywhere? Or is each moment associated with its own place in the universe? If this last possibility is the case, then there is more than one time. There are times that might intersect but never coincide. But in this project, I'm interested in one time, in one place. First, I'll write down the history of the first minute of the war, which wasn't the first war I've seen. Most of the people who tackle history record centuries, decades, and years. I'm interested in minutes. Especially the first minute.
The minute will be a three-dimensional space. It will be a place where I snipe at things and souls as they move, the juncture where they meet before disappearing forever, without saying goodbye. Humans say goodbye only to those they know and those they love, whereas things say goodbye to each other and to humans, too. But we rarely hear their voices, their whispers, because we don't try. We rarely notice things smiling. Yes, things have faces, too, but we don't see them. Those who do see them after making an effort and training themselves to do so, and those who talk to them are labeled mad by your standards. I'm the one who saw everything, and I see what they don't see. There's always a moment in the life of every being and everything in which their whole truth is manifested, a moment when the past intersects with the future. Those who can see and hear can discern the truth about that being. You no doubt sometimes see a photograph of a famous person, or even an ordinary person, and you realize that this photograph, slash moment, preserves the whole existence and history of that person. I'm not sure, but many of these condensed moments come just before death. I know I contradict myself sometimes. Is there any way around that? Time is a black hole, a hole into which things fall and disappear. Even the beginning of this whole universe, according to one theory, was an explosion, and the universe is just fragments and debris. And here we are, living the consequences and effects of it. I'm going to pluck this minute out of the black hole. But why? There are people who write in order to change the present or the future, whereas I dream of changing the past. This is my rationale, and the rationale of my catalogue. I liked the preamble, the idea of a history of the prey and a catalogue of the first minute. These were wild ideas that were not afraid to take risks. He could elaborate further, of course, and set his mind to arranging the sequence of ideas. I jotted down some notes in my notebook. I kept reading as we waited at the Iraqi border post at Trebil, and again as we waited at Al-Karama on the Jordanian side. I thought of writing about Wadood and his project. It could be intertextual with his catalogue, including excerpts from it. Why not? But I had to find out more about his background and his life. I scolded myself for getting carried away with an idea that was wonderful, but totally impractical. Are wonderful things ever practical? I had to finish my doctoral dissertation to secure my job. And I had to turn it into an academic work. And after that, I might be free for novels. That would be logical. But it's not my logic. Abu Arif drove me to the airport because my flight was due to take off in 3 hours. Roy and Laura planned to stay in Amman and visit Petra and Wadi Rum.
"We need a holiday after all that pressure. It was so intense," said Laura,
who overused the word intense, often for things that didn't deserve to be described as such. We hugged, and I thanked them for the opportunity they had given me and reminded them that my offer to help them translate the film when it was finished still stood. I don't know what came over me when I agreed to go to Baghdad after all those years. It would have been better to go alone, at least to ensure that I had freedom of movement and could choose what I wanted to see, instead of being hostage to the team and its schedule, to which I was committed. But what was the point of all these recriminations now? There wouldn't be another trip. I had gone without expectations and thought I had immunized myself against any additional disappointments. I had read a great deal about what happens to immigrants who go back after a long absence and, consciously or not, search for what is left. I had read about selective memory and nostalgia and its snares, but the texts didn't help much. The Colloquy of the Caliph. Harun al-Rashid's features were distinctive, and anyone who saw him could not easily forget his face. His eyes were black, often staring into the void. When he was angry, and he often was, they glared. His eyebrows, mustache, and beard were gray. They were bushy and longer than necessary. He didn't have much hair left on his head, except around the temples. He had a dark complexion, wore a gray dishdasha over a pair of pants, and walked barefoot most of the time. No one knew where the caliph lived. From his appearance, he didn't look as if he even had a home or that he owned many things other than what he wore. The street was his home, his palace, in fact, as he used to shout emphatically at the top of his voice. He would scold the passerby for daring to walk on his sidewalks without obtaining his permission or paying taxes. "This is Al-Rashid Street, my street, the Caliph's street, you motherfuckers, not your mother's street," he would say. This shocked many people and they kept their distance out of fear. But those who knew the street grew used to him and knew that he wouldn't attack anyone physically, but would only shout and argue. The shopkeepers humored him and paid him a pittance in tax, some dinars or a cigarette for temporary relief from his shouting. He would go up and down the street shouting at the cars, too. Sometimes he ventured farther afield, went to the El Shuhada bridge, where he stood in the middle, looked at the tigris, and shouted at the fish. Or he would look at the sky and shout, "Your God is full of shit!" This latter expression upset many people, and they would ask for God's forgiveness. Some of them would rebuke him, but he would respond with another such expression in a loud voice. There were several stories about the history of the caliph, and it isn't possible to verify any of them. One version was that he was a rich merchant who had lost all his money after several bad deals and unwise decisions that had forced him to sell all his possessions within 1 year. He had gone mad after that. The other version said he had been driving his car at breakneck speed on the road to Mosul and had collided with a truck. The truck's load killed his wife and 3 children, and he was the only survivor. The third version said quite simply that depression and madness had run in his family for generations. He had been placed in the Al-Rashad hospital for many years. It wasn't known how he had ended up in Al-Rashid Street, but his real name probably was Harun. Harun was inspecting the street corners, looking for one of his subjects or his ministers who, whenever they saw him, pretended that he wasn't the caliph. He wanted to rebuke them. He couldn't understand why his kingdom was uninhabited this morning. When I got back to Cambridge, I had to meet my advisor before moving my stuff and going to Hanover in New Hampshire to prepare for the coming semester at Dartmouth College. I had told him by email that I had got the job and thanked him for the letter of recommendation he had written for me 2 months earlier, but I hadn't told him about my trip to Iraq. I liked him very much and was in awe of his encyclopedic knowledge of Semitic languages and everything related to classical Arabic literature, especially poetry. Apart from writing dozens of articles and papers, he had been one of the editors of the vast Encyclopedia of Islam. But my one-on-one sessions with him were strange. He was painfully shy, and in conversation with him, one had to work hard to overcome the moments of silence, whereas in his emails he seemed more easygoing and relaxed. Maybe he felt most free to interact with others when he was handling their research papers and dissertations. He would write astute comments, incredibly useful suggestions and references, and sometimes sarcastic comments. When I reached his office on the 3rd floor of the department building, the door was open, and I saw him trying to arrange some books and academic journals on the shelves. I knocked and went in. We shook hands. "How was your summer?" he asked as I sat down. "Fruitful, I hope?" "I don't know if you like the kind of fruit it produced," I said with a smile. He laughed. "I wanted to thank you again for your letter of recommendation," I said.
"Ah, yes. Congratulations on getting the job."
"Thank you. I know I wrote you to say that getting the job would give me an incentive to finish the dissertation quickly."
"I hope so," he said.
"I was supposed to submit the 4th chapter, but for the last month I've been busy with a project I hadn't planned for. I went to Baghdad as a translator with a team filming a documentary." He raised his eyebrows.
"Really?"
he asked.
"How was the trip?"
"To be honest, it was disturbing and psychologically draining."
"I'm sure,"
he said, looking through the window at the sky.
"You know," he continued, "I was 4 years old when the Second World War ended. But I grew up with its ghosts and with the memories that adults in Cologne had of it."
This was the first time he had spoken to me of anything personal.
Sometimes you have to do what you have to do, he added. The important thing is to get back in the saddle and grab the reins again, as they say.
I was surprised at what he said and relieved that he was so understanding. I had thought he would express some disappointment.
As you know, I lived in Beirut for more than a year when I was young, he continued. I was helping Fuat Sazgin with his encyclopedia. I visited Cairo, too, but I've never been to Baghdad, unfortunately. And how are your relatives? Most of them are here, aren't they?
Yes, my family's here in Virginia. But I do have relatives there. They're well.
I read that the libraries have been damaged and many manuscripts have been destroyed.
Alas, yes. We didn't go to the National Library or the museum, but I went to the Faculty of Arts, where I studied, and the library there had been burned down.
It's a crime. People are more important, of course, but...
But?
War is nothing but what you know it to be and have experienced. What is said of it is not conjecture, he said. Didn't we read Zuhair's Mu'allaka together in the pre-Islamic poetry seminar 3 or 4 years ago?
Yes, 4 years ago.
But politicians don't read pre-Islamic poetry.
I laughed derisively and said, they don't read any poetry.
Some of them read poetry, but they might not understand it.
He always insisted on academic precision and avoided generalizations, even in casual remarks. He stopped talking. This was the first time we had spoken with such familiarity, and I wanted the conversation to go on longer. But more than a minute passed without him saying anything, and I decided it was time to leave. I stood up, thanked him for his patience, and promised to send him the overdue chapter as soon as possible. He stood up, shook me by the hand, and said, I look forward to reading it. I called to mind the first lines of Zuhair's Mu'allaka as I went down the stairs. Are there still black traces in the stone waste of Al-Daraj and Al-Mutathallam, mute witness to where Awfa once lived? Her abode in Al-Rakmatain appears, like tattoos on the sinews of a wrist. Herds of wild cows and white antelopes wander there. Their young ones spring up everywhere. There I stood after 20 years, at pains to recognize the abode. Blackened stones marking where the cauldron was slung, and a trench like the debris of a cistern. When I recognized the abode, I said to it, A good and very morning to you. I couldn't remember any more. I repeated, A good and very merry morning to you, twice as I went into the department office. Jenny, the secretary, wasn't behind her desk, and there was nothing important in my mailbox, just ads about student grants and new courses in the fall, and an invitation to a party welcoming new students. I threw the papers in the recycling bin. I wanted to tell the secretary that I was moving and give her my new address so that she could forward all important papers there. I waited 5 minutes, but she didn't come back, so I decided to write her an email later. On my way back to the apartment, I was approaching Divinity Avenue and Kirkland Street and suddenly felt like going to the Adolphus Bush Courtyard. It was the most beautiful spot on the Harvard campus for me. It's a secluded garden hidden behind the Museum of Germanic Art. Although it was on the way to the department and the library, I discovered it only in my last year there, thanks to Rebecca, who pointed it out to me when I complained there were no quiet spots on campus. I started going there to read when the weather was mild. Sometimes we would meet to have a brown bag lunch there. The garden was deserted as usual. The semester hadn't started yet, and anyway it was half deserted, even when school was in session. I sat down on one of the benches and looked at the statue of the Brunswick Lion, which now has a light green coat because the bronze has oxidized over the years. Although leaning forward and about to jump, it was peaceful enough to allow birds to nest in its open jaws, which the sculptor had frozen in a roar. The nest looked empty and still. The red ivy was climbing up the walls of the gray building as though it wanted to reach the roof. The glass and the enormous windows reflected the walls of the building opposite, the statue and a piece of sky. There were four gargoyle faces at the top of the columns, like the ones placed on churches and other old buildings to ward off evil spirits. I realized I hadn't spent enough time in this enchanting spot. It was normal to feel that, as I was about to leave the city and knew I would miss it when I was 2.5 hours away. I could visit, of course, but it isn't the same as living there. I should call Rebecca. Our last conversation had been very short. I hadn't missed her much when I was in Baghdad. I had thought about her only once since my return. My heart was uneasy, preoccupied with conjugating the volatile emotions that swirled inside. The present and the past continuous, more like commotions than emotions. But at the end of the emails I sent from the Sheraton, the only place where we found an internet connection in Baghdad, I exaggerated and wrote, "I miss you too," in reply to her, "I miss you." I didn't know how long our relationship could last when it was sustained only by phone calls, Yahoo Messenger, and a short visit every 6 months. I wanted to sit on the bench and doze off for a while. But I had to return dozens of books I had borrowed from the university library and finish packing my books and other stuff into boxes before the movers came in the morning to take them to Dartmouth. When I went back to the apartment, I looked for the commentary in the Mu'allaqat to read the rest of that section on war. War is nothing but what you know it to be and have experienced. What is said of it is not conjecture. When you stir it up, you stir up something ugly. When you provoke it, it will roar in rage. Then it will grind you like a millstone. It gives birth unexpectedly and produces twins, and yields you a harvest very different from the bushels or silver that villages in Iraq produce for their people. It took me 4 hours to finish putting all the books, papers, and other things in the brown boxes I had bought from the moving company. After sealing each box firmly with tape, I wrote a few words about the contents and the place where it should go, such as office, apartment/books, and so on. Luckily, Dartmouth was going to pay the moving expenses.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.